But in dark times when we close our eyes, it's a nightmare. It's a nightmare. When the sun don't shine, we lose our minds. But I swear we can get there.
This is Dr. Ed Park, and I'm recording part 3 of 9 in the Exosome series. This one is about parabiosis and what it teaches us about aging. Parabiosis is sewing two different creatures together, and they've done this for decades. And what they found is that on a cellular level, despite having different genetic makeups, the younger mouse gets older and the older mouse gets younger. This experiment has been recapitulated, and indeed, when we think about how the mechanism could be taking place, we know that these are genetically incompatible individuals, yet somehow the messaging, probably through exosomes, is able to confer different behaviors in the target cells. Is this done through also a hypothalamic pituitary clock or control? Yes, possibly. The hormones produced by younger cells and the signals and the ecology, if you will, are different. So what we see is a sort of funny take on this. In one of the episodes of Silicon Valley, the billionaire gets young blood from a young man and hopes to get younger. What we see here on the bottom right is a picture from a very funny movie called The Man with Two Heads, where these two gentlemen were sewn together. And of course, even though it is sort of funny and indeed grotesque, there is something to be taken away from this. So what is it about histocompatibility that we need to understand? Well, on the surface of cells, all nucleated cells, there's something called major histocompatibility antigens, or MHC for complex. These identify self from non-self, and it's a very important part of how we work. T-cell immunity is adaptive immunity, and it's potentiated by the secret handshake, as shown in the cartoon above to the right. The major compatibility antigens come in two classes, class 1 and class 2. The class 1 is, again, identifying self, and the class 2 also is a self-identifier, and they perform different functions in terms of recognizing antigens and signaling for when a cell says it's been taken over by pirates or like a virus or cancer and needs to be killed. Exosomes, in general, lack major histocompatibility antigens because of their size, because of their provenance and why they're made, although the exception to that is exosomes coming from immune cells. Antigen-presenting cells, adaptive immune cells, do produce exosomes with histocompatibility antigens on their surface as a way of enacting their functions. This cartoon on the bottom right illustrates this point, which is that in the adaptive immune system, sometimes you do need histocompatibility antigens. Indeed, even antibodies released are probably released from these exosomes as well. So what is graft versus host disease? Graft versus host refers to the fact that if you take someone else's cells and put them in you, those cells will start to attack you. And this is a truism of xeno, meaning foreign, grafting. When you talk about allografts or xenograft, meaning usually from a different species, there's a huge unspoken incompatibility. If you go get black sheep's cells, your immune system will recognize them as incompatible and destroy them quickly. But also true, if you take mesenchymal stem cells from a non-matched donor, your immune system will clear them as well. They generally don't take hold and overwhelm you unless you are, of course, immune compromised, as in the situation of people who have intentionally destroyed their bone marrow in an attempt to get rid of cancer. This HLA mismatch, or a major histocompatibility complex mismatch, again, causes most cells, including the ones you pay a lot for, in terms of off-the-shelf stem cells, to be destroyed. Although there is some cloaking, not necessarily compatibility, but because MSCs are so immunosuppressive via the Th2 and Treg system, they may be able to hide for a little longer. Now, MSCs, or stem cells, are broadly immunosuppressive, as shown by this article by Kati Reddy. So this article shows that if you take stem cells from the same person, MSC stem cells, it helps the person not reject a corneal transplant at a very high rate. If you give stem cells twice on day 0 and 7, it's almost as good. If you give it just once, it's good. And if you give no MSCs after a corneal transplant, it is not as good. So there is a broadly immunosuppressive characteristic to MSCs, despite their source. Of course, same source or isogenic, syngenic is always the best. Of course, as I mentioned earlier, the immune-compromised host can be harmed by a graft, but usually your army will overwhelm the introduced cells because there's so many more of your army. But nevertheless, as we discussed in the last lecture about aging, chimerism, or the existence of different kinds of animals, literally, but cells specifically, is an ongoing process of aging, and that I guess theoretically, if you take someone else's cells over and over again, there is the ability of those cells to engraft and become an immigrant population into your own ecology. Mesenchymal stem cells are, as we showed with the cornea experiment, broadly anti-inflammatory. I refer you to the lectures of Dr. Arnold Kaplan, who wants to actually rename them from mesenchymal to medicinal. He was very much a pioneer in understanding their behaviors and their actions. And whereas once we thought they were mesenchymal, meaning they tended to engraft and differentiate into cells of the mesenchymal or mesodermal sort of origin, we find that they can engraft and become many different types of cells. And in fact, their actions appear to be medicinal, or like quarterbacks or barefoot doctors, as they actually live out their functions. The picture on the top is from one of the most profound war movies of all time called Full Metal Jacket. And I think that movie is interesting because it shows that in the first half, at the Paris Island training facility of the Marine Corps, they learn to kill. And one of the recruits, of course, goes haywire, ending that segment of the movie. And in the second half of the movie, they learn to not kill, and they struggle with the moral dilemmas of that theater of combat. This person in the helicopter is shooting civilians as they run through the field. Presumably, he believes some of them are Viet Cong, and the question of the reporter is, how can you shoot women and children? And he responds literally and concretely by saying, you just don't lead them as much, meaning you don't shoot as far ahead. Okay, so why bring this up? Well, the thymus is where the T cells get their name from, and the thymus is where our cells of the adaptive system learn to kill. But before they graduate, they also have to learn self-tolerance, or the second half of the Full Metal Jacket movie, which is when not to kill. So before they can graduate from the thymus, they have to learn to kill and recognize self, but they also have to learn to not be overzealous. Otherwise, we can have problems with autoimmunity, which are, of course, untoward and undesired effects. When we talk about inflammation, there's two phases. Usually the first is the raise the alarm phase with histamines, complement, cytokines. This is associated with what we know as the calor, rubor, dolor, and functio lassa, meaning there's heat, redness, pain, and loss of function. Interestingly, the MSCs come in and they sort of put down police tape. Instead of escalating this first responder alert, they tend to limit damage, limit apoptosis, and they take the T cells and shift them from a Th1 to a Th2 sort of phenotype. They also increase the differentiation into T regulatory cells, which are broadly, at least in terms of that model of inflammation, anti-inflammatory. It starts to clean up the crime scene and to rebuild and regenerate and shut the whole system down. What is SASP? This stands for senescence-associated secretory profile. And it's just a broad descriptor of how cells behave badly, and they tend to sing bad tunes, out of tune, negativity. When cells are damaged, as shown in the cartoon above, they're damaged, but maybe one of their genes involving in cell cycle regulation involved in suicide are not functional, then it can be damaged but not able to kill itself. And what we see is that the contributing arrows are telomeric damage causing chromosome level breakage and mutation. This is associated with loss of oncogenes and cell cycle and apoptotic suicide programming. So we have a damaged cell, damaged genes, damaged chromosomes, inability to die. That is a senescent cell. And the phenotype, or the secretory phenotype, the kind of exosomes, if you will, and the kind of behaviors it's putting out are bad. So what we have to assume is that in the old mouse, it's putting out bad exosomes, pro-inflammatory, negative sort of exosomes, and the young one is putting out good ones, if you will. So what we have here is that we want cells to behave young. We have to send out young songs, young signals. In the event that a cell is old and unable to kill itself, then our hope is that with the exosomes, containing messenger RNA and proteins that may be absent by virtue of mutation in the host cell, especially the host stem cell, that they could be transiently replaced and trigger that last step of apoptosis repair or cell cycle arrest, meaning that the damaged old cells are less represented, less productive, less pouring out of their exosomes, and even able to die or undergo what we call senolysis. So how do exosomes work? Well, they involve cell signaling proteins. That's like the gas on your car. They have a microRNA, which are specific matched RNA sequences that will bind to messenger RNA and keep them from being translated into proteins. So that's like a break. But they also have messenger RNA, which is like a clutch, allowing you to shift into a higher gear. A messenger RNA not only is one protein, but can produce many, many proteins simultaneously because it's read by the ribosomes in what's called a polysome. And so it allows you to really kick it up a notch, if you will. I refer you to Dr. Kaplan's lectures on YouTube, Arnold Kaplan, who, again, wants to explain what MSCs do, why they're so beneficial broadly. And he goes into how they're immune modulators. Again, they limit acute inflammatory phases, and they also downregulate autoimmunity, which in most cases is a very untoward process. I want to close with this quote from Dante's Inferno. Was signed to the Inferno, said, "Abandon hope, all ye who enter here." And then the cute little thing is, if you've already abandoned hope, disregard this notice. Why do I say that? Well, if I was to ask you to explain music, you might say, well, music is this phonograph needle in this record groove, and on the right and the left are the right and left audio channels that produce a sound wave. That's shown in the middle. Sound waves are this. They overlap with overtones and harmonics, and as they travel through time, they create what we perceive as music. Or you could say it's sheet music. It's these organized tones in sequence and harmony, and this is the song Let It Be. Or you could say music is what vibrates in a dish of water or sand. If we look at the traditional right tuning of 432 versus the current tuning of 440 for A, what we find is that the patterns even are more geometrically pleasing and simpler depending on how they vibrate. Or you could say that, you know, music is what makes this person dance. And I guess that's maybe where I'm going with this, is that we need to abandon hope to understand what exosomes do. What does the song mean? It depends on who's listening. Is it an old cell, young cell? What type of cell? Are they able to hear it? Are they able to enjoy it? What is the dance repertoire that they embody? So again, it's hard not to be oversimplistic. We will never understand any more than you could explain to somebody without ears or a perception of rhythm what music is. These cells are speaking their own language. But in a nutshell, can we benefit from youthful paracrine signals? Well, according to the parabiosis experiments and this theory that they're communicating through exosomes, then the answer is yes. Certainly the young cells can be aged by the older crotchety cells, and that not all exosomes are the same. I refer you to lecture 6 of this series, Are All Exosomes Created Equal? And of course they are not. And this will segue well into the next lecture, which is entitled Exosomes and Cancer. Thanks so much for listening.
We can get feeling in a jar, pass around to